You're listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network, now the largest new media platform on the web and your number one source for after-show entertainment. AfterBuzz Studios in Los Angeles, California, and streaming live on Ustream. This is AfterBuzz TV for Boardwalk Empire. We'll break down tonight's episode and get you all the latest Boardwalk Empire news and gossip. If you'd like to buzz in on tonight's show, you can buzz us at 424-256-1729. That's 424-256-1729. And now, picking up where the show leaves off, and the buzz continues, it's AfterBuzz TV for Boardwalk Empire.
Yay! Hello, Bethany Jaber here, and I have got quite the crew with me for Boardwalk Empire. This episode is titled Under God's Power, She Flourishes, which I find very interesting because we really hit this episode with a huge Oedipus complex with Jimmy. Van Alden finally gets into some serious trouble, and Nucky and Margaret are at odds. They are not in agreement, and so
it's so many big no coming back from moves,
right?
Exactly. There's just no coming back from a couple of things. It's like, oh my god, for me it was one of the most loaded episodes I've ever seen.
Yeah, point of no return for sure.
Hopefully. Especially for the Commodore.
You never know, though.
Yes.
He's been coming back a lot.
Yeah,
and from and also for Van Alden, John, now what do you do? He just shot a federal agent. It's like there's not even a chance of him going to court and fighting this. Wow.
No, he's gonna go straight right. I mean, where else can you go but running right into the arms of the people he's pursuing?
Right. Yeah.
What other places he got to go to?
There's nowhere else.
Madness.
Nowhere else to go.
We're getting ahead of ourselves, yes. but it's just a mind blowing episode.
It was.
It's an Emmy Award. I think this is the episode that you send to the Emmys, right? I mean, I can't imagine you'd send anything.
I would because for Michael Pitt.
As a whole.
He became 18.
Oh yeah, yeah. That was fabulous.
I mean, come on, he changed his hairstyle and he shaved. At the end of the day, physically, but it's like what this guy did as an actor.
I know.
I totally bought into it. He was 18, 19 at college.
Absolutely, like a college kid.
Yeah.
And then from a writing perspective, in about anywhere from a quarter to an eighth of an episode, they completely explained to us why Jimmy's world, why he's the way he is, why the mother is, why the wife was.
Yep.
How the kid came about, everything, and just
all those things that they've referred to for a while
for
in
two
the series,
seasons.
We've suspected the incest between the two of them, and we finally got a lot of answers tonight. So I thought that was fascinating.
Just from a writing perspective, what a great way to tell backstory and make it fascinating.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and what a wonderful way to just keep misleading us and hold off on the inevitable. Because I don't know about you, but when I sat down to watch this tonight, I was like, okay, let's see what Jimmy thinks about all this. And they were like, nope, not going to do that.
Exactly.
We're going to go back in time.
Right. And so at first I was like, oh, you guys, you left this for the last episode, sons of bitches. But yet, as we got into it, I was happy because I enjoyed seeing the flashback. I enjoyed all of that.
And I also thought that was a great way to show what exactly he thought of it. Because it was a flashback. Or was it a flashback or was it a drug-induced flashback?
Right.
And so what?
Yeah,
so
that's what I'm thinking.
He went to, did he just go to Princeton because he was just so frustrated?
No, he went to Princeton to sell the booze.
While he's there, he does the drugs and he reminisces about life at Princeton.
The ambiguity of when did he find out and when did he take the drugs as opposed to the flashback. See, I think.
Yeah.
Which is better writing is that he finds out and
he
takes the drugs because he can't handle it.
Yeah. It's kind of what I ended up thinking, but I really liked how we actually saw him before the war.
Yeah.
Which has colored everything up until this moment, and everything that he's done.
Everything.
Has been about that, and he was so different.
I agree with you. I think I was assuming that the writers would let us see the moment that he finds out. But they didn't. They didn't give that
to
us.
They
did it in an interesting choice,
a non-linear fashion, and they kind of let us decide how it worked out in our own minds.
No, that makes it more realistic because when you even hear something, nothing is linear like that. That kind of news or that kind of events won't make sense anyway.
No, it never does. Does it?
In his point of view, like from his point of view, this makes no sense. I mean,
I think for the type of the quality of the show that it is, now that you guys all say this, I think it probably was. It was he heard the news and
for me, that's what it was.
And got depressed with drugs, and which is such stronger writing than you know going through a flashback.
Thing. How many? It's an interesting choice not to show it, but how many times have we seen that moment?
Yeah.
Where somebody's found out bad news and then you can see this was for me it's a much more interesting way to show it is don't show it. Show me what he was thinking about. Show me what he remembers. Show me what his life was like and lead that all up to that moment where you see him on the ground and
Mess.
Up his nose. You really already know everything. I don't need to see the moment because I saw everything that led up to this moment.
What did you guys make of his relationship with Angela at that point?
I think
in
he
time?
Loved her. I think he loved her. Remember was it last week that he was talking to her at the beach?
Yes.
I think he loved her, and I think he's always loved her.
Yes.
And it's destroyed him and just brutalized him because the woman I really love doesn't love me.
Right.
And the woman I don't love.
Yeah, wants me.
I feel like there were two Jimmys. There was the Jimmy that should have been and then the Jimmy that ended up being.
Yeah.
And I think I wrote somewhere in my notes.
In two ways. But not only because of what his mother did, but because like they had the professor. Now what would it have been like if the professor was his nookie rather than nookie?
Right.
That kind of thing.
Right. He was
his
on
mentor,
this path. So he's on this
mentor
path to be at Princeton and to be mentored by this other fella. And you know, he meets this girl, and even though he doesn't know her, I buy these. Like, I know you're a good person, so it's like we can make this work.
Yeah.
And he's off to this path where he could have been a captain of commerce, and she was an artist, and And the between the mom and it just for me, I wrote down it was like the mom.
Oh my God.
Really, just
okay. Before the mom though, but just because he's the only guy on the bat. If I could just ask you, when the professor, the dean is mentoring him in that way.
Yeah.
Didn't you really respond to that? Didn't you? Because you know, we all as
when
a guy,
they were in the small group.
Yeah,
in class.
We're all as a guy. We want that mentor in our lives to like you know tell us the truth, give us the show us the ropes, all that other stuff.
But Bethany and I were both waiting for the trap door to open.
Exactly.
Like, is he gonna be gay? Is he gonna hit on him?
That's what I thought.
We were like, is this Penn State?
We knew
like, something. What's going on?
We knew it was gonna go wrong in some way.
Well, of course it had to. But at that moment, it was legit.
Yeah.
Which like, makes it just more
you really
hard.
Isn't that Michael Corleone when you go back, you know, like, he was on his way.
He was going to be the war. He was the war hero.
War hero and, had ideas about things outside of the family business.
That's right. I'm not them.
But he got.
I'm not going to be them.
But then got pulled.
And then I'm with you now.
Yep.
And then his mom literally came out from nowhere and literally held him down. But that's another thing.
He was willing.
Go there. Okay, that also, he could have fought that. That's a whole
thing. I was drunk.
Exactly.
Can we go back to Van Alden before
because
Jimmy's
going to
be like, there's
like
a 30-minute discussion on Jimmy.
Okay, so let's do that. Let's hit Van Alden. My goodness, where to begin? He signs the divorce papers.
Yeah.
He's looking at,
but he signed it when...
In the office.
When Margaret Shorter came up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
When the subject of Margaret Shorter came up, and it was so great in shooting because you have the FBI crew in like a three shot, and then you have him so far away at his desk, sitting there alone, completely just doesn't connect with these people, which I love.
Yeah. There's literally like an archway in between them.
Yeah.
to keep him back.
Yeah.
He's like, what? What
is he? So you guys, what is it about hearing about Margaret, who we know he just kind of loved and obsessed over?
Absolutely no impression on me whatsoever.
Ever. And then signs, So why?
I think what could have been, that's the goodbye to that life, that possibility. That not only did I screw up with my wife, I did even that woman who I really respected and in whatever way adored, because I don't even – that was such a brief encounter, but it had a huge impression on him. He's – all of it's gone.
It was signing away that life.
Yeah.
And it's great because that gets paid off later because the Van Alden as this Elliot Ness super agent is now
on
gone.
On the lam. On the lam, baby.
He's gone.
Yeah. The pursuers become the pursued.
And how interesting was it with the parents his talking to
the
nanny, who's starting to really have feelings for him. And again, I was like buying into the whole like, oh, maybe these two will end up as something. Yeah. And when he tells the story of his mom and dad, being part of some almost cult,
Second coming of 1892.
Exactly.
And the guy buys into it and sells everything, and they live in a tent. And he said but after that whole experience, he can't bear to face me. Why can't he bear to face Van Alden?
You said something about that.
Embarrassment.
Yeah.
I was embarrassed of his son.
I'm embarrassed I was wrong. He knows it.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why.
He can't be embarrassed in front of because the father never wants to be embarrassed in front of
his
son.
How can you be a man to your child if you've just screwed up the whole farm, literally?
Right. I gave away your right as an inheritance. I gave away your
everything.
Whole future.
Yeah.
All for some stupid thing, and it didn't prove to be not true.
Yeah,
How do I face you?
I was flim-flammed.
Exactly. How do I face you
every day?
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, I guess probably this is more to predictions because we need. But I had a feeling. I don't know. Do you think we'll ever see these two freaks?
Who's that? The parents?
Yeah, the Van Alden mom and dad.
That would be awesome.
That'd be interesting.
That would be amazing. Yeah.
Because
well,
right now, especially now,
he's got
us. If he doesn't go back to try to make some deal with the bad guys, where's he gonna go?
It's possible.
Dad, you think you screwed up? Here's what I did.
Yeah.
Oh God.
It's possible.
That would be nice.
Weren't you guys stunned at the when? I mean, I was surprised that the lawyer came in with the evidence right away. I thought this was going to be something for next season, or they would threaten him quietly and get him working for them.
Right.
But to come right in with it and for him to shoot.
I didn't expect the shooting and the running.
Oh,
the assistant.
No, not at all.
I thought there would be something else going on, but that'll be interesting.
But Van Alden as a character is constantly surprising us.
That's true.
So are you guys I had seen him as the grand antagonist of this show.
Van Alden?
And from the press he's getting, it seems like it's Pitt and it's Michael Pitt, Buscemi, and him are the ones. So is this the beginning of the end for him, or does he still have an 8-season run in him?
God, we are totally getting into predictions, but I've heard and this is just rumors. Now I'm gossiping. I hate gossiping.
We love gossiping.
I know, but this is the AfterBuzz.
I have heard, and I apologize because maybe he's a lovely ass actor, but I've heard he's really difficult on set.
Michael Shannon.
Difficult. Yeah, is that true?
Does anybody
know?
No, I've heard. I know he's very serious.
Okay.
And he's very I think he's one of those guys. He takes it very, very serious.
I'm gonna put him in the category of misunderstood.
Okay, let's go there.
You know, but okay. So if let's just say let's say that's the reason.
Yes.
I hope that's not true. Because I like these series to be more organic. I'd hate to be like, okay, we got to get rid of this guy, or this guy got a bigger part somewhere else. Yeah. I'd like it to be more.
I would too.
According to whatever the story arc is,
and not what's happening on
set.
But that being said,
it's a long term prediction, so it's not really a prediction for next week. But long term, do you guys think
because here's the thing: if he stays, and let's say that everything's hunky dory, and he stays. Then you've got a story about a guy who used to be the Elliot Ness.
Right.
And you can take him down to the worst of the worst.
But my thing is, I guess what I'm trying to figure out is, and John, we're writers, so let's just think, what do you do? Granted, criminal science isn't that far ahead, so there's always a better chance of a criminal being on the lam.
Yeah.
But what benefit would he have to the bad guys at this point where he doesn't have a badge to help them facilitate? He doesn't, he doesn't have a strength there. Mm-hmm. So unless he's kind of some psycho who's stalking them, but that's a short term.
But he still doesn't want to associate with them, that guy.
Well, that was before. That was before.
He's not even found out.
It's not, but my point is, where does he fit in for 7-8 seasons?
Yeah,
how do you keep him going without him getting killed or caught? And if he doesn't get caught and goes and hides somewhere else, and then
he loses all of his interest. Yeah.
Right. Then he's living with his parents up in the boondocks.
That won't be interesting.
Yeah,
so I think it's kind of the beginning of the end for him.
I think I have something. Well, Nucky has a lot of sway with the African American community.
Yeah.
So maybe he can get them to change their story.
But he just shot
another
federal agent and ran.
Yeah, and the whole reason why Nucky did it is to get himself off. I don't know why he would change that now, because it's a good strategy.
I don't know, man. I think
the only way he could do it is if he turned and became one of them. That's what I think. Is if you wanted to
became
carry
a gangster.
For, yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Became one, but he doesn't have any power.
Not yet. But the way you get power is by giving them something.
What you know saying?
Knows
I wonder.
Everything.
Oh, there you go. That's good.
Everything.
Okay, so he knows.
He knows. Who's
he knows their
what.
Strategy. He knows the everything. Prosecution strategy.
And he knows what so and so did to so and so. I know what you did to so and so. He knows the stuff that you know. Rothstein doesn't tell Luciano, and Luciano doesn't tell Meyer. He knows all that stuff.
It's very valuable information to one of them.
Remember that folly? Just the folly he had on Nucky was that huge. Mm. Remember that?
Right.
Yes.
So he knows where all the ghosts are buried and the bones are hidden.
I guess so.
So he can help the bad guys. Yes. That's valuable. That okay, nice. That's a value.
Is it okay if we jump over to Nucky and Margaret?
Yeah, please.
Because Margaret is pissing me off. I'm sorry.
Yeah. She's self-righteous about the
She's not being a good gangster wife.
She's
not being a good gangster wife.
And I know I'm supposed to be on Nucky and Margaret, but like whereas is it Gwyneth Moll?
Gretchen
Moll.
Gretchen Moll. There we go. Gretchen Moll. So sorry. Whereas her character is so steadfast in what she believes.
Well, she's gangsta.
And what happens?
She is.
She's
and
so
like,
gangsta.
You know, she is consistent to the core, and I love that. Margaret is just flailing all over the place.
She's flailing. I like the Margaret that went to Nucky's office and smuggled his money
yes.
out like that
and
Margaret
book,
we love
right?
in his book yeah. that this Margaret yeah she's letting us down.
She's a little she's almost a little manic.
But you know by the way she's getting good advice, you know, like the subtext from the doctor when he was talking about the daughter, you know, she said no going back to crawling.
Yeah.
You know.
Mm. No, that's true.
We won't let her crawl.
I like that. That was a beautiful quote.
You're right. And so
right.
we why are we going, you know, I feel like she's taking it the wrong way. Then what did he say too? Oh, that she needs to support herself. Talking about the daughter with her
braces.
Her braces, and I think it's seen as like I need, you know, Margaret needs to now support herself, but it's like.
But she's also having this conversation with Nucky in the bedroom about like these parables and just all these like
the spoons.
And he's like, well, this is what the story means. Like there's hidden meaning behind it. And she's like looking at it very like literally.
Well, he was hilarious at his very his short sighted view. So why don't they just use
why
they
don't
can't
they
bend
just
their
choke
arms?
Up
can't
on
they
the
bend
spoon,
their arms?
For God's sake.
Yeah, it was hilarious.
But
so
like,
funny.
So, yeah, so pragmatic.
Is
yep.
she yeah. is she a bright woman? Is she not? I mean,
yeah, she's
like,
bright, but she's,
bright,
with
but,
guilt.
But
yeah.
by the way, we
she's
yeah.
having
you
a
before,
crisis
you Catholic?
Of conscience.
I was raised Catholic, yes.
So don't you know, like, that's totally
Catholic
how
guilt.
You are?
Yes.
Yes.
I do know that.
So I'm saying whether we like what she's doing or not, I feel it's completely organic.
It's
to an Irish
her
Catholic woman.
What she would
that's
do.
Yes. It's the Catholic guilt that clouds
John, think
your
of
judgment.
Your mom.
Oh, my God.
It's
right?
So, it so goes against her intellect. That's what drives me nuts.
But yeah, but that's
But it's the Catholic
guilt
spell.
Does.
And by the way, all right, I'm not going to say too much more. By the way, that's why none of us are successful as Catholics. because our intellects are all, you know, it's not enough. It's too much of the, you know, man, why don't you...
The medical term is magical thinking.
Yeah.
For me to think that like, oh, I cheated on my husband or my lover. And so, you know, that's why I got into the car crash. Like, they're
yeah,
not
but you don't, but
linked.
You, but... I mean, my whole life, God punished you. That's what you'd hear if
yes.
you
yeah.
if you laughed at someone or made fun of someone,
like
then tripped
you,
and fell.
Gotta keep
of
you
see?
In check.
And that just, I don't know, it doesn't leave you because it's still in me.
Yeah, it's still there.
No
it's
matter.
So
still
dictated
in me.
By guilt.
Yes.
And then.
And fear.
Yes. And then Nucky is like, hey. Well, what have you cheated on? Like, yeah. I love, he goes through
yeah.
that list.
By the way,
so
I wrote
yeah.
down,
right?
I wrote down,
right?
I hope Phil's listening to this. I want Nucky to run After Buzz. I just think he's amazing.
That's his dream job.
He just stays totally
amoral.
On business.
Yes.
Oh, see, I didn't see that part. I see the part that doesn't buy into the magical thinking. He's just staying on point.
What have you stolen?
What have you done? And I love it. It's like,
he's
no, if you're going to flush your life, you're not going to flush mine.
Exactly.
Oh, what are you going to strike me now? And he's like, no. Don't make it out to be like, I'm the bad guy, and you're the good guy, and this priest you're going to is so good because he's taking money. He's on. We're all on the take. We're all doing our thing.
But what drives me nuts is she's only willing to go so far with this. And she's like, well, you killed my husband. And I'm like, hold up. No. The question was about cheating.
Right.
Yeah.
And like,
I know,
who
but that's,
did you
she's
cheat
called
on?
Being human.
Projecting, like, the guilt.
But if she's going to, like, take on this new persona... I think she needs again, to.
I'm surprised. I don't think he had enough Catholic church.
I was gonna say.
Yeah, we need to go take a walk down.
I'm just
there's
cranky.
One right on the block.
I am cranky.
It's a nice
with
one.
Her.
We have to go.
No, I get that, but you know,
oh,
it's funny.
I do.
No, let's do
the
Sunday
way that
morning
she's
mass.
Thinking about it. Okay, oh, cool. God. I'll sleep in, and you guys can all go to Tammy, and I will sleep in.
That's it.
I just have to re-educate Bethany because she's forgotten how wonderful it is.
Oh God.
Well, the thing about like Hinduism, like in India, it's just practical, and it's just the thing to believe that if you do something wrong, then the universe gives it back to you.
Karma.
Yeah. Right. And it's not weird at all, but it's totally from the different angle of it, whereas Catholic guilt, you know, like God's punishing you.
I've been in California too long.
Thank you.
Right? Sorry to interrupt you.
No, that's really funny.
There's the, that my New England-ness is
Southern
like,
California.
Southern California.
Yeah,
thank
let's
you.
Get it right.
Is,
yeah,
is,
that's right.
Has
seriously,
has left
Southern
me,
California.
And I forget what that guilt is like. I don't want it back, though, honestly.
Don't get it back.
You don't want
go
it back.
Back to crawling.
No, no, no. You don't want to go back. No. No, Nucky has it right. He realizes it's all a sham.
Yeah, but I mean,
just be as decent as you can.
Yeah. Try not to kill anybody.
Right. Try not to.
But if you have to.
But if they're going to kill you, you got to kill them.
You got to kill them.
I mean, as he always says, I'm a gentleman until forced to be otherwise.
That's right.
What did you make of Harlan, the manservant that was like, he was going to
spill the beans?
Yeah,
I think another guy, because Nucky's such a fair guy.
Yeah, that's right.
He's so just decent, not a saint, obviously, but he's so decent and so. He's been decent to this guy and to the people who work for him, so they feel like they want to help.
Yeah, but he almost left the room.
Well, because he didn't understand. You know, if Nucky knew what he was trying, you know, the guy was afraid to speak his piece.
Yeah,
but the lawyer he would have gotten there eventually.
But
I think
probably. Yeah, but the lawyer who's sharp, which I really like the new lawyer.
Yeah.
He was sharp enough to say, "Wait, come on, let's hear this guy out."
Yeah.
But
and it's only after that till he knows his first name. Harlan, is it?
Yes. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
That's
yeah.
Great. I know. That took.
No, I can pay attention.
But I like it because again, because Nucky he's always decent. You see when people come into that office crying about family problems or whatever, he's happy to give them a little money and send them on their way. So it's
very.
And by the way, Chalky is a little meaner, but you see a little bit of that in him too.
Yeah.
But that's why the people are so loyal.
Yeah.
To them.
Right.
They're good. They're good leaders. In
but you know the best mobsters that I dealt with.
Give them just enough.
Whether well no you know what they didn't they never it was so interesting. It was one of the more progressive things about them.
Mobsters. this is an ugly word.
They were
businessmen.
Businessmen. Yeah. Organized businessmen.
Organized businessmen.
But the better ones were not racist. They were they saw everyone as equal, gay, straight. I you know it was.
It was
like,
only until you did something wrong.
That was it. And then if you messed with their business.
Yeah.
Other than that, and so it was very interesting that they were. You know, you would think that they'd be the ones, but I think because they kind of felt like they were outsiders in their own way.
Yeah.
They actually were. So, they were more receptive.
Yeah, they understand
of other minority groups.
Just trying to make a living.
Right. So and that's how they felt with them. I got no problem with those people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't care how anybody
that
makes a living
sense.
As long as it doesn't interfere with mine.
That's it.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, it feels very organic to me, and I like seeing it.
What I love about it is the conflict of it. I like that she's stuck in the middle and that she's not quite flipped to the other side. She doesn't know. All she knows is my kid has got polio.
It's
and back
polio?
In that day, it was almost a death sentence because of the way she's going to get ridiculed.
Right.
And she just, I brought this on her. How do I make it right? That's all she's trying to do. Just like Gretchen Mol is like, oh my God, how do I make it right for him? I mean, they're all doing the same thing.
Exactly, and it's
how
great writing.
How do I make it right for my kid?
How do I just make it right for my little universe?
Exactly, that's you know? What they're trying to do.
And you know, we
wrong
talked about
and crazy and irrational, but that's
well, look
motivation.
At well, speaking of that, like even the priest took the money.
Yes,
but bad writing would have been like he, you know, pocketed it for himself or whatever.
Right.
But what I was saying in the weeks earlier is like, no, they totally would take the money, but then they would go.
They'd rationalize it.
They'd give it away to poor. They'd set up a program. And in this case, he's building a parish hall.
Right.
And then he goes, and we need a roof now.
Yeah,
I know.
But I'm still going to extort you.
Right. And she's like, that's not what I said.
But that's what I meant.
Yes.
That's another amazing thing about religion, but.
But he needs a roof.
It's never enough.
It's interesting, right? He's got almost everything he needs.
Just a
roof.
A little bit more.
So again, it's a great character, and I buy it. I buy it with the priest I knew.
Yeah, that's, you know. Might be a little that might have gotten in the market.
Well, he,
you
has
know, the
to
priest I knew, John. You know, and again,
no, they wouldn't need to.
None of them ever did. Their lifestyle is so amazing,
right? And everything's done for them, so they don't have anything.
I mean, they like made. I think it was like the guys I knew made. I forget. Now, of course, this is back in the '80s, but it was like $110 or $115
a
week.
Mm-hmm. Oh, a week. I thought you were going to say like $100,000.
No. But as John said, everything paid for.
They need for nothing.
Everything is paid for.
Yeah, absolutely.
So,
and of course, they get all the ego boosts. Everybody kissing their butt all week.
And by the way, at everyone, no, you'd never let them when you go out to dinner with them. You never.
Oh yeah, no.
And when the families take them out, no one's ever letting them pay for anything. So, and the ones I knew never. It was, they were never wanted money. Now they enjoy. Enjoyed helping people. They might have liked power, but I never saw anyone after money.
No, you know? Because their currency came in different ways.
Yes,
it just didn't come in money.
The bartering system.
And you know, there
I will absolve you.
Well, you know, and the last thing probably about we can talk, should talk about Margaret is her mister. Do you think about me? He shows up.
Oh,
and
nice.
The maid.
Yeah, what's her name? The maid.
Katie.
She's like, mm-hmm.
Now here's a question: mm-hmm. Was Margaret upset about the fact that Katie saw her, or was it the subpoena that really got her in that mood? Before, because that's the two things that happened right before that scene happened between So which one was more?
I think
effective?
A little. Those are excellent questions.
Easily, this one is the exterior one, but the interior one I think is the one that really
hurt
her.
I would agree. With that.
She just used this as the ploy to talk about the other.
It's snowball.
Yeah. It's snowballing. You know, the daughter and this.
Clearly, it's on her mind because she said, "I've stolen, I've deceived, and I've cheated." So sorry.
Yeah. But does Owen really think about her? I mean, come on. Really?
No, I think he's totally full of it. Guys like that.
I think he does.
I think he does too because because he's got his bims. He's got the maid and those people for
bims.
His like sex.
That's right.
But like for someone real,
is it because she is saying no or is it because he really likes her?
Both.
Yeah, that's a good question.
I think both reasons.
Like the chase.
Yeah.
Because she is the type of woman to say no, and that, you know, that's what he likes about. He likes about that kind of woman.
I don't think he has any idea of what a genuine relationship is.
Yeah,
I really don't.
I mean,
he's a player.
He hasn't spent any time with her.
I think she's a conquest. I think she's, you know, she's the pinnacle.
Dames.
Yeah.
She's the unavailable. She's got some cash.
I don't deny that
hobby.
That's not part of it, but I do believe
you
that
think he has feelings for
yes,
her.
Yes, because
they're
she's
obviously not fully developed.
Because they're from the home country.
She's beautiful. She's also very smart.
Yes. Oh, well, there's no question that she's desirable in all those ways.
But,
I just
but
don't
more
know
than,
that.
Like, say, the maid.
Yeah, more than that. Yeah,
who's desirable and you know physically desirable
and
fun.
Yeah, it's just a fling. This is more than that.
But Margaret's more.
He respects her.
I mean, look at Nucky. He could have any girl he wanted in that city, and he wanted her.
I'm
so
dubious.
She's got something special.
Van Alden,
special.
The same thing.
You know? Van Alden, too, yeah.
I'm ready to get to some Jimmy. How about you?
Yeah, let's get to Jimmy.
Is that okay?
Oh, yeah, no.
Jimmy and Gillian.
I mean, we open up with the beautiful sequence of them in Princeton in the tiny little dorm room. She looks so young.
They both did. They did a wonderful job.
It's almost like they did something with her teeth or something, because she reconfigured her smile or something
hair,
because
makeup, well, everything was
hair
nicely.
And makeup for sure, but but she was, you know, she just looked so young and innocent, and it almost looked. I mean, it really looked like she had lost those 10 years or however long it was.
Yeah.
It was the first time that
I actually felt
that she deeply loved him. I mean, I think in every episode, I know that Jimmy loves his wife. But it wasn't until this episode that I saw her like true deep affection.
I
for
absolutely
Jimmy.
Agree. I think this is the first time I'd ever seen that.
And
she at one time really loved
much
him.
Much affection.
And
lots
it,
of affection.
Yeah, it just made it just broke my heart a little bit more because I was like, oh crap, you really do love him. There was something there.
There was something there. And you have to remember this was college and so we all what do you always hear from people saying, you know, geez, the person I met. And 10 years later, I'm a different person, and that person's a different person, so we're not the same. But at the time, we see something special. This is also before he went to war.
Yeah.
Yep.
And where his soul was murdered.
A little bit.
Right? And then, you know.
And before he had sex with his mom.
Right.
So.
Right.
And you know, before he beats up the teacher, which is, you know, one of the first
thing.
Of a series of, you know, bad choices he's going to make. With the mother's influence. It was interesting after
like, that's the last time he was innocent.
What, with his mother? Or no, with professor.
With anything.
At that moment, that young love, that innocence was
gone,
it was gone
shattered.
When he beat up the teacher. Right. And it was. Did you guys look at the two shot of
First Casualty Award?
The mother's reaction and Angie's reaction.
Oh, that was amazing.
Yes.
The pushing.
She's horrified. You know, yeah. Angie's horrified. Like, this isn't. Like, I'm an artist. This isn't what I wanted. I'm at Princeton. This isn't the life I chose.
Mm-hmm. And mom is.
Jillian's just turned on.
I think she's titillated by the whole thing, man.
Yep.
Yeah, this is foreplay for me.
Yeah, that's my boy.
It turned out to be foreplay.
Which right?
It was just such an interesting. I'm not that this is like the MC Hammer story by any means. That's an odd segue. But whereas like your past or where you're from just constantly follows you, like you can't shake it. No matter like how hard you try, it's impossible. It just never goes away. Like you think you're gonna create this new life somewhere else. And it just does, and it just doesn't happen for Jimmy. And one of my favorite things that they do in this series constantly is they take a very public event, such as the Lusitania, being sunk, and they turn it into a private event. And we see how it affects people's day to day lives.
I like that. Yeah, and to add on to that, Jimmy turns it into makes it his own history.
Story. Yes. Mm. Yes.
Twisted on his head again.
Yeah, his first, like, again.
He co-opts it for his own history. Because he hates his own history.
Right.
He's running away from it again.
Yeah.
Trying to make his own, this is now what I was.
This is my new thing. And, you know, with the scene before, he's like, Kaiser never did anything to me.
Yeah, exactly.
Which is, by the way, the classic, like the classic mob line is like.
Cassius Clay.
Right.
Not my job.
Muhammad Ali,
my fight.
Well, yeah, he was more.
No Viet Cong ever called me, nigga.
I was thinking of the Bronx Tale, where it was Chaz Palminteri. He's like, why would you bum out about Mickey Mantle? Didn't he have some line about that?
Yeah,
he's like, he ain't crying for me. He ain't paying my bills, or like that cynical kind of.
That's one of my favorite movies.
View. It's amazing.
Oh, my God.
It's a terrific movie, yeah.
Oh, be still my heart.
But, you know, do you notice when they, you know, when they went, when they were talking in his dorm room, mom and he, before she meets.
When she first arrives.
Yes. And, you know, the kiss on the forehead.
Yeah.
It was, I'm like, where do we get to kiss on the lips? It was kiss on the forehead.
It's true.
And I'm like, oh my goodness.
You got a good eye.
I'm like, I wonder when they're going to show us that, when they're going to fill this gap.
When did they first start doing that?
Of course.
Yeah.
They ended up showing us.
Yeah. So you would say that was the first time that they were intimate.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would agree.
Oh, yeah. Like
that boundary.
Oh, here's a question for you guys. Yeah. Was that the only time?
Since then?
That's a good question. I don't know.
No.
Well, now, I want to just talk a little bit about, was this the first time? I think probably Jillian was, like predators do, was crossing that line all through his childhood. She talked about it.
Yeah,
a lot of covert incest.
I was just about to say that.
They call it covert incest.
Exactly.
The boundaries. There's no boundaries. She has no sense of boundaries or any healthy way to show that affection.
You know, it would be very difficult for somebody who was taking it, I thought I was younger than that. Yeah, taken to the Commodore.
Yeah.
So she has no sense of what.
So, begs the point.
That's a relationship.
So, if you guys are going in this line of thinking, then maybe you were as horrified as me when she's carrying up the grandson.
Oh, yes.
Says, I'm going to lie next to him.
Yeah, yes, definitely.
Absolutely.
She's already done it. And you can see, I think, is Jimmy in his head, is he saying, I have to kill her?
Yes.
That's what I thought.
He already tried.
He thought about it. I think he thought about it. He did already try.
I think that's been in his head for years.
And she's already making herself, because Angie's gone. Tommy.
She said it's all perfect now.
Everything's fine. Mommy's here.
Yeah, she wiped out everybody. Commodore's gone.
That's right.
Yep. Wife's gone. Yep. Nucky's gone.
Yep.
Now we can start our new life together.
Yep. Be a real family.
I have to say, she's my favorite female on the show.
And you know when
she's
when
drop dead gorgeous.
When the little boy says, "Where's Mama?" And she says, I'm right here.
Yeah.
That's what the line was. Yeah.
I felt like she made herself. That was the moment where he was like, oh, crap, I'm going to have to kill you.
Yeah, you got to.
Well, you know, she
you
was like
protect
going
your child,
off.
You
got
to get rid of her.
She was going off for a while, like, oh, you have to do this. And I don't mean to sound cold about this, blah, blah, blah. And I was just waiting for him to just flip out.
Yeah.
Which he did.
So do you guys think, Mike, again, I asked a question. Do you think they've been intimate that was that their only
was it the one time
one
or
time
that,
or?
I think that was the first time that they
I think it was
like
the first time
the
I think it was the first and only time because right after they went to the war and we saw what is the relationship when they got back from the war.
It was the first consensual time, I think.
Consensual? I don't think she ever. I think
abused
she. I think
him?
She crossed lines, but I don't think she ever.
Well,
I, think ever
no, I agree because she said she was saying to him, she was telling him how okay it all is.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's okay. It's okay. It's not. You know. Like,
but I don't think they went that far. But she said she kissed his thing before. She said
when, she,
that,
when
that's
he was a little.
Right.
That's what I'm saying. She
a
crossed
baby.
Lines, but I don't think they ever had into. I think that's.
Oh
when he
yeah,
was a
I don't
kid.
Think they had sex, but
I, mean,
I
tiny
think,
baby. I you know I don't think she.
But I think that if I think that. Her reality obviously is like really different, but I think that she crossed a lot of major lines.
Oh,
but
yeah, all
that,
the time, yeah.
But that this he was like totally aware
just
of
just the way she
totally
talks to him
it.
Crosses the line right there. That's part of the covert incest that's going on. Just the fact that she treats him not as a son but as a partner is
well,
incestual.
And when she covered for him with the police officer who came to, you know, and Richard was sitting there and the guy's going, you know, where's Jimmy, what do you know about him? And she just completely covers for him. He's a simple man, can't you see?
Oh, poor Richard.
Yeah.
Did really he need to? Do we gotta slap him around? This guy hasn't been through enough.
Yes.
He's a simpleton. Just ignore him. I think I wrote down some of the quotes. We cringed.
It was pretty disgusting.
I thought
disgusting.
It was awesome.
And yet at the same time, he couldn't speak. He's just so distraught. The man couldn't say anything. He's just desperately sad.
And it just shows
grieving.
You how like cut off
she
is.
Wait, do you mean in general or do you mean because Angie's dead?
Oh,
because
Angie's dead.
Yeah.
I mean, Harold loved her.
He did. He loved her.
Okay. Loved
she
her.
She painted him. She
yes.
did all the things. Saw who him, for who he
she
was.
She saw the
was.
Humanity
accepted
in him.
Accepted him for who he was.
And now she's gone. And that was really, I mean, although him and Jimmy are friends, I mean, I think they had a deep connection. Or
yeah, more so
that.
Than Richard understands, because Richard is always asking Jimmy.
Are we friends?
Yeah.
So he doesn't understand that friendship yet. He doesn't feel it, not like he did with Angie.
I'm actually curious what Harrow is going to do about Manny Horowitz rather than Jimmy. I'm wondering if Harrow is going to go, like, and maybe we're
that's
getting
a,
into,
yeah.
into predictions, but he was the one that really just, I mean, you can just see his pain.
But yeah, I thought the way that Ginny did it, Jimmy's mom,
Gillian,
I beg your pardon.
Yeah.
When he said he's a simpleton, and said, I thought right there, it's like, geez, if you had any doubt about how cold, calculating, and just
manipulative,
shut off. She's just totally
just
shut up.
Total manipulator.
Nuts.
Totally disconnected. Yeah, that went away when the Commodore got her, you know, did
that. And again, you know, she's crazy too. Cause I mean, how, you know, she, you know, you were talking about, you were mentioning something about her being clear and I think she's just nut bat out crazy because on one hand she doesn't want you to kill the Commodore. Well, just finish it. I mean, she's like, make up your friggin' mind.
Right.
Yeah. See, that's why I think she's nuts.
The poor
clearly
Commodore.
Commodore had a tough season.
He did.
Whatever, dude. I do not feel bad.
Really? Thankless job.
Yeah.
No.
Are you kidding
and talk
me?
About
no, he was heinous.
He lied in his own bed.
Yeah. But you know,
that's
it's interesting.
True.
He stabbed Jimmy. So,
in the back.
Yeah.
In the back. So he needed to. He needed to be wrapped.
And there was that whole imagery of like, I mean, he did.
And it's interesting, done with knives. I'm sorry to because we're talking about it because that, you know, when you talk about how any killing with knives way
close
more personal.
Combat. Yeah.
Because why not use a gun? Excuse me. These are gangsters. They
have
guns
them.
Lying around everywhere.
Yes, they do.
No, but I thought that was a smart choice, writing wise.
Well, it's personal.
It's close quarters. Yep. You have to be facing that person to have all that happen. Stabbing in the back. Can you get me? Come on.
Yeah. We're on the same track because when he's sitting there with the recruiting officer, he says, "I wanna
stab
the Kaiser in the gut." And so his father
Kaiser,
being the
Commodore.
Kaiser.
Right.
He does get him.
Great
in the
pickup,
gut.
Bethany.
One of my favorite moments cinematically in this episode was, you know, when Jimmy wakes up in the morning and he looks out that window for an escape and all of his options are in front
of
him.
I know, literally.
There's like quite literally there are the train tracks that he looks at.
Yeah.
There are the kids,
party kids
having fun,
party.
Which he's so disconnected to. And then the one thing that he does feel connected to is the army. Mm-hmm. And he sees them kind of marching along in an orderly, very.
And I think it's the order that he's going for.
It's the order.
Out of the chaos that he's living in.
And it's the distance. It was the
That's
thing
true.
That was
and
also
going away.
Physically furthest from him in the window.
Furthest from his life.
Yes, exactly. It was the furthest from his life. And it just,
get me the hell out of here.
from a storytelling point, we didn't, of course, there were no words. They just did such a beautiful sweeping shot with that. And we're like, we know exactly where you're going and what your options are. And then it just, yeah, it made me happy. I was like, and this is why I love this show.
Do you guys know the play Death of a Salesman?
Yes.
Oh, yes.
So it's, you know, American classic, whatever. But that's all, the only image that I kept thinking about when Gillian's character, Gillian, was talking about, like, how she's so lonely and she hates the look of suitcases and stuff. Yeah. And how, like, in Death of a Salesman, he just goes door to door to, like, all these people and he ends up, I don't want to, like,
it's okay.
Could, yeah, he killed himself.
It's right. In the title of the play.
Yeah.
That's true.
You're not going to, it's okay. And how,
it's good.
Yeah, how,
spoiler alert.
It's all, like, classic American imagery and just getting out of the, like, American dream, all that stuff, all of his options.
No, I agree with you.
He's, disillusionment.
He's complete disillusionment, and he's going very far away. And how, I don't recall how long he is away at war for. I guess
long enough.
Three years.
Long
enough.
His son.
And World War One is generally known as more brutal than World War Two, right, John?
Yeah, much more grisly.
Yeah, absolutely.
Our ways of killing weren't as efficient.
No.
Say that one more time for me.
Our ways of killing in the World War One were not as efficient as they are today.
So even though World War Two was the more hit radio war, it was more popular.
More deaths, but not as.
But World War One was more brutal.
Yeah. Not to digress, but if you are a World War Two fanatic, and you like TED speeches, if you're familiar with those, I love them. Malcolm Gladwell has a great one that's like on one of the front pages right now, and it talks about like the Norden bomb dropping technique and how they crafted that and how inaccurate it was, and how we had the technology before the Germans. And so we thought, like, this was going to win the war. And it's just, I don't know. I love Malcolm Gladwell. So if you get a chance to check that out, please do.
Who is Malcolm Gladwell?
He wrote Outliers.
And The Tipping Point.
Wow.
Yeah, the whole idea behind that, like, before you become a master of something, you need to do 10,000 hours of it.
You know,
which clearly everybody on Boardwalk Empire has done their 10,000 hours because they're kind of fabulous.
Well, why don't we just go to commercial?
Let's
do it. Finally talk about predictions.
Okay.
After Buzz TV. Hi, I was once like you, a lazy, angry loner whose only joy was watching TV and surfing the net. And like you, after I'd see one of my favorite TV shows, I'd be so excited and have so many questions that I'd actually have to talk to my douchebag coworkers about it at the water cooler. Then I discovered AfterBuzzTV.com. AfterBuzz TV produces after-show webcasts and podcasts for TV series of all kinds. Like post-game wrap-up shows for all your favorite TV shows. AfterBuzz TV hosts are industry insiders who break down episodes of shows, take calls from fans, and interview cast and crew from each series with over 60 different aftershows, from Boardwalk Empire to American Idol to Vampire Diaries to Real Housewives and more. Now, after a night of TV, I can ignore my stupid coworkers, who I hate, and go straight to my desk and watch or listen to all my favorite AfterBuzz TV aftershows and have all the TV fan interaction I need. Thank you, AfterBuzz TV.
AfterBuzz TV. What do you want to buzz about?
I feel like I'm the one who should be talking.
With that music and that sexy
voice.
Absolutely. Uh-huh. Let's hit predictions.
Let's talk about predictions.
Who wants to go first?
Well, we missed the prediction.
We didn't get to see next week.
I think that's even better.
Yeah.
Because
so
then
yeah, to fill
nobody,
you guys
like,
in,
tells,
we,
tilts the
our
cards.
Our TiVo cut off, so we weren't able to see
next
HBO's predictions for next week.
But it's the finale.
Yes. It is the finale. So we just can shoot from the cuff. You know,
let's start with Van Alden. Anybody got a take on him? I mean, we didn't know. But
I mean, will this be his last episode?
Yeah, please no.
I hope not.
I really hope
I don't think
not.
So.
I don't think so either.
I think we're going to follow him a little
I would
while.
Think he's a fascinating character, right?
I think he's
going to
be
right?
part of the cliffhanger. I think he's going to be a bit of a cliffhanger.
I think he's going to go gangster.
You do?
Yeah.
Okay.
Clearly, I don't say gangster.
He just hates them so much.
But he hates himself more.
Okay.
So that's what makes me think that he could do it.
That he could kill himself?
No, that he could turn gangster.
You know, we didn't talk about our mini mobsters.
Yeah.
The Muppet Babies.
Yeah, go ahead.
You know, and the way like Capone, you know, they really bitched out Doyle.
Yeah, they did.
And you know, you see that a lot too, you know, in you know, you hear about a lot in stories, mob stories, but even just in business where that one person just gets disrespected.
Yeah, like, and I go, how often do they, how many times do they have to do this before they realize in doing that, you're just creating the enemy.
Right.
It's just going to screw you.
Yes.
That's right.
And I don't, you know, I believe Capone does it.
Well, they're Muppet babies, but they're Muppet babies. That's true. They're when only kids.
When did Capone all of a sudden have no love for Jimmy? Like, that was a total,
well, he's a
like,
sociopath.
Yeah, okay. Yeah,
so he's not going to, that guy
it
is,
just
no.
It was such a character change for me, I was like, where are you coming? I thought you were, I totally
buy that with him. No,
because when
from
the power started happening for each of them,
that guy doesn't love it. He doesn't really love anybody. Yeah. He's just very conflicted.
I think he's just pals with whoever's in front of him. And
this is the guy who shot the gun next to
him. That's right. And if they're and if you're partying with him, if you're having fun with him, or you're making him money, great.
But
if you're getting in the way, no. You're gone. You're gone. You know, but it's interesting.
One sociopath to another, I agree.
Yes. Yeah. So, you know, we see with those guys, there's going to be, you know, there's going to be hell to pay with them.
Yeah.
You know?
What about Margaret? What does anybody think is going to happen with Margaret?
I think
Wait, do you guys think that she like admitted to Nucky that she cheated?
No, she didn't admit.
But
no, they're gonna save that.
I don't think she's gonna throw him under the bus for her husband. Yeah. But I do think she'll eventually admit to Mr. Slater.
She will eventually, but they're saving that for next season.
Yeah, I think that'll be our cliffhanger.
Because
that's my guess.
She needs to. Like re-squirrel away the money because she just gave it all away to the Catholic Church.
Duh.
She's planning on coming clean. That girl.
But
needs
Nucky's
to
giving
fight.
Her
and
all
these
the
hundred and these 160 acres. Yeah, it's really gonna get messy. And so Eli,
I think at some point she's gonna realize that okay, just by coming clean, I'm gonna put my children, both of them.
It's
at
interesting.
Risk.
Oh, Eli,
I can't do that.
Eli won't flip to the cops.
No, I don't think
he won't.
That's interesting that he won't.
Yes.
Because I thought for sure. All bets are off with the two of them.
Yeah, and they still are
for
but,
sure.
Yeah, but. I don't think he'll flip, but I still think if he had his chance, he'd screw Nucky another way, but just not with the cops.
Because he hates the cops.
Only so his own ego is satisfied. Mm-hmm. So
he feels
like he's a more empowered brother.
Yeah, I'm not a rat.
A snitch.
That's exactly
right. I don't want to be known as a snitch.
Not because,
But by the way, it's like I love when prosecutors threaten the chair and say, okay, well, you won't get the chair, really? So I'll be 60 years, like, getting ass fucked in prison.
Chair.
You know what? Fucking fry my ass. Let's wrap it up. Like, are you
I'm
really?
Done.
Like, I love when
you
they
got me.
But I guess, like,
I'm out.
But John, I guess, like, with criminals, they love themselves so
much
that's
narcissistic,
that they want to
exactly.
preserve their life. That they're like, no.
Well, and I think on some level they may have conscience where they think if I die, the sooner I die, the sooner
I'm
going
to
hell.
I'm not going to a good place. Yeah, maybe. Yeah.
Which, okay. Which brings us to Nucky. I mean, do we have a series if he goes to jail?
No.
Way
by the way, historically, I don't even know if he goes, but he has a very long career in the true character.
Yeah.
So I think we're fine. And no, we don't. We need no.
Even if he did, he'd run things from
prison. He would.
That's true.
How about the butcher?
He's gone. Dead. Oh, he's going to pay.
And I think
Richard, he's dying next week.
I like the idea that Richard does it.
You're right. That's a great call.
Absolutely, Richard's going to do it.
Yep.
And Gillian
dead as well.
And I hope
it's not
from some
far away shot either.
Ooh, they might need Gillian for more
contact.
Stuff.
We
might need Gillian for next season to give us more to talk about.
We've gotten rid of two of our big females already. Like, they got rid of Lucy and they got rid of Angie. So I think we need to keep Gretchen. I will be shocked if they get rid of her.
I want them to keep her because I think she's fascinating.
She'll make
it
another season. I think all bets are off after that.
And we gotta have another one of those scenes with Jimmy. I mean,
and who's she gonna hook up with next?
By the way, I mean, I don't know, right now with Breaking Bad not being on the air, I'm saying best show on television right now. Nice. best drama. This
Boardwalk
is like
by
oh
far.
My goodness, just like the amount of work and the layers and you're talking on all levels, your cinematography, costume, music, acting, writing, directing. It's all there. We're really lucky to have this.
Jimmy, we didn't decide what's happening with Jimmy.
Well, he's got the drugs coming on, so he's going to become an addict.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's going to be great stuff.
But we'll see a little of that next week. But next week, he's going to, I think he's going to be, maybe go to Nucky to make the peace, maybe?
What
to work
kid?
With Nucky? Well, don't worry about the kid. The kid's
Gillian. I don't know.
Mobster guys, as long as the kid's protected, he's not worrying about being father of the year. He's got bigger things right now to worry about.
Yeah.
I don't think he's going to go to Nucky yet.
You don't? I don't either. Yet? No.
No. Well, not for the next show. No.
Okay. I think they're gonna rendezvous at least in the next episode. They Nucky and Jimmy need to
Do you think? I mean, I know it's like the '20s, and it seems like we could just kill anybody and get away with it. But like, how is the Commodore as a public figure? He's stabbed in his house. Like, how does that get handled? Where does does the Commodore's money go to them? Which would be
whatever the will says.
I'm sure
they can hide that.
If next week's episode is better than this week's, my brain will explode.
I think it will be.
They got to cover up. The Commodore was already on death's doorstep, so they'll figure out a way to cover up that he was stabbed. So that's gonna be tricky.
Because
he's already dead.
That's gonna cost some money.
It is gonna cost some money, but they've got it.
Yeah.
Right.
And you know, once he's dead, I'm sure not all of it, but I'm sure
just
most of them.
Get him right in the ground. No, you got to cremate. Fellow criminals out there.
Yeah.
Really, as soon as possible. Got to cremate.
We're demised.
Oh, sorry. What? No evidence.
Autopsy. He was on this.
You want to exhume the what?
Exactly.
Oh, we have his ashes.
Everybody's expecting him to die at any minute anyway, so it wouldn't be a shock. Oh, he passed away in his sleep at night.
They'll cremate him.
Cremate immediately. Jesse, get us the music. We're getting thrown out of here by Phil.
Okay,
being cremated right now.
You can catch us at 7:15 on Sunday nights directly after Boardwalk Empire.
Bethany, how do I find you?
How do you find me? You can find me at Bethany on Twitter, and it's Bethany with an IE. What about you?
At Undergaro.
Awesome.
At Tamara Jewelry.
Lovely.
At Macedo Music.
You can find me at Ralph's.
Nice bagging, cozy, but you're good at it. That's what matters.
Thank you so much for listening, and have a good night.
See you next week.
From producers Keven Undergaro and Phil Svitek, engineer DJ Jesse Janity, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. If you have questions or comments, be sure to buzz us at info@afterbuzztv.com. And you can find us on Facebook or follow us on Twitter by searching for AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.